welcome, everybody. Thank you so much for being here at this last great Radboud Reflex lecture at the end of the year, and a great lecture it sure will be. We are very glad and honored that Martha Nussbaum, world-famous American philosopher, will be here tonight. She's here on our book tour. Anger and Forgiveness is her latest work. And we're very happy that she's here tonight to speak about this book. She'll give a lecture of about 45 minutes, and afterwards, Dean of the Faculty of Philosophy, Theology and Religious Studies of our university, of the Radboud University, Christoph Lüthi, will interview her on her book. And afterwards, there's plenty of room also for questions from you, from the audience. She won't be signing her book. She asked us to give us a bit more time for questions and answers, and I'm quite sure that you'll agree that's the best option. So without further ado, I will welcome the dean of our university, the Radboud University, Hans van Krieke, or not the dean, the rector, to give a true word of welcome, to welcome here on stage Martha Nussbaum. So first, Hans van Krieke. Thank you.
Good evening indeed, and also a warm welcome on my behalf. It's a great week for our university, actually. Tomorrow, students from all different faculties of our university will play across the Karel Keizerplein, and they will play music of Dvorak, and it will be a great evening where employees of the hospital, the academic hospital and the university come together, and Friday they do it again for the personnel of our University of Applied Sciences. On Wednesday, we have a farewell lecture of one of our obstetricians. In his 30-year work, he was very influential in making childbirth from a medical technical to a emotional personal happening in the hospital. And then on Thursday, more than 20 of our staff members, scientists, will sign the books they've written this year. And these are books on politics, on philosophy, on economics, on personal life, all kinds of things. And on Friday, we expect very interesting work from our cancer researchers, but I cannot disclose that. But of course, the highlight of this week is tonight, where I'm very proud to welcome here in Nijmegen once again the distinguished philosopher and professor of law and ethics, Martha Nussbaum. Like many of you, I came to know her at the end of the previous millennium, when we had a series of very interesting interviews by Wim Keizer of the VPRO, Van de Schoonheid en de Troost, where Martha Nussbaum was one of the persons who was interviewed and explained much about her life, her youth. I remember that very vividly, and I saw it again yesterday, and I remember the wordings of those. And I think many of you came to know her then and learned about her. But of course, at that time, she had already written quite influential books on education, the importance of the humanities, on emotions. But now, tonight, she will discuss her more recent, this year published book, Anger and Forgiveness. Now, when I was in medical school, which was in the 70s of the previous century, anger was seen as one of the most primitive emotions, and the thing you had to do to control this as soon as possible at the young child. And when you failed, persons would become later patients, having maybe asthma or an ulcer, a gastric ulcer. We know now that there are other causes of those diseases. But anger as an emotion remains a very important one, and I'm very curious to hear about the thoughts and ideas Martha Nussbaum has developed over time and will explain to us, and I particularly look forward to her lecture now. So I would like a warm welcome and a big round of applause for Martha Nussbaum.
Yeah. So what we'll do now is we'll have a conversation of about 20 minutes, and then we'll open up the discussion to the floor and the roof, and see how far we get with that. We have about time until 9:15, given that there won't be any book signing. Well, you gave a wonderfully emphatic lecture on anger. It was originally meant to be Anger and Forgiveness, like your book.
Well, and they didn't ask me what the title was. I would have said Anger and Revolutionary Justice.
Not knowing what you were going to say, I read your book.
Yeah.
And it was a wonderful experience in the sense that you're telling us that neither anger nor forgiveness is what we should strive for. Anger is the wrong emotion. Forgiveness is the wrong way to react to it.
Well, it's much more complex than that, if you give me a chance. Because there are actually three attitudes that are in the ballpark of forgiveness, and shall I say. So what I'm saying is that the typical form of what I call transactional forgiveness, which is the perhaps in Judeo-Christian organized religion, the dominant one, is too conditional. Because it says, I will waive my angry feelings toward you if you first perform a kind of abasement and you confess and you promise to be different and not to do it again and so on. And to me, this is a kind of concealed form of anger that is very unpleasant. And you see these political spouses on TV and they say, oh, shall I forgive him or not? And then he has to come and say, I was a very bad boy, and I'm so bad. And so, you know, to me, this is unpleasant. It's hierarchical. And of course, it's hierarchical because it was translated from the relationship of the believer to God, but it doesn't quite make sense in the human world. So then there's unconditional forgiveness, which we see a lot in the Christian Gospels, where we have angry feelings and we waive them without a precondition. No, that's a lot better, but we still have the question, was it right to be so angry to begin with? And we also have, there's a kind of covert moral superiority in unconditional forgiveness, because St. Paul, for example, says, forgive them unconditionally and you will heap coals of fire on their head. So, you know, I'm not so fond of that either. What I like is unconditional love and generosity. And that's often, it's common in Judaism and Christianity too, only I think we see it, for example, in the parable of the prodigal son, where this father sees the son a long way off. The son doesn't even have a chance to say whether he's sorry or not sorry. And the father runs out and simply embraces him with strong emotion. The text says his guts were heaved up, like he felt a very powerful surge of love. And then, of course, he could also instruct him and try to get him to change his life, but the love came first. So that's what I'm in favor of.
Now we've had the full lecture as announced on the program. This is wonderful. Thank you so much. Now, but let's stay with anger. One of the things that is interesting, you start with antiquity. You started also tonight with antiquity. There is also another way, starting from antiquity, to talk about anger, namely the medical Galenic tradition, where anger is also something that can be part of a character, of a temperament. You can be choleric. There is a wrong mixture of saps in you. And when you think of the way in which we talk about people, you can say, well, this is a very irascible person, or that's an angry old man. And in that case, it's not a response to a situation. It's more a character trait. How do you deal with that?
Yes, you're right about Galen. But I think Galen was probably a great biologist and doctor, but a very bad philosopher. His criticisms of the Stoic theory of the emotions, according to which emotions embody evaluative thoughts, like what I described, is very bad, because he just pokes fun at it in ways that show that he hasn't actually understood it. So I think to give people a free pass because you say, oh, well, they're really choleric people, that is just a way of excusing bad upbringing. We all know very well by now that, especially in America, little boys are encouraged to display anger. Little girls are encouraged to restrain it. And so, of course, that would be the way a choleric temperament would be produced, by not moderating itself appropriately in childhood, by having the teacher say, oh, isn't that manly or something. And of course, the paradigm of sports, especially American football, gives you the sense that this is a great way to be. And so people, you know, because society valorizes that, then people get a free pass when they behave badly. And I think, you know, the truth is that everyone, well, we don't know enough about any kind of innate difference. We know basically nothing about it because culture comes in so early in the way that babies are held and so on. But there's no reason to think that anyone has to act angrily as a standard, stable matter.
Let me try to approach anger from yet another angle. You have this wonderful book, which I think you cite somewhere in your own book, by Charles Darwin, 1872, The Expression of Emotions in Man and Animals. And then he says, well, in animals, we can see six different key emotions, and anger is the first one he mentions. And then he's got these photographs and drawings of an angry cat, an angry dog, and, well, we could say he's angry like a dog, mad as a dog. Now, wouldn't that mean, at least for Darwin it meant, that anger is something we cannot avoid? It's simply in us. Would you say anger is necessarily part of our nature, but we have to transit quickly? Or is there a way of, that would be more the Stoic attempt, to get rid of anger altogether?
Well, I guess I would agree that there's a kind of precondition of anger, a kind of strike back, protect your turf tendency that's probably present in our primate ancestors, although not all of them, not the bonobos, as Frans de Waal has very beautifully shown in all his wonderful books. And I know he's here in the Netherlands right at this time. He's not in the very room, but he is in Utrecht right now, he told me. But anyway, he's shown that even the genetic thing is pretty flimsy, because the bonobos, who are as close genetically to us as chimps, don't behave this way at all. But all right, let's grant that there might be some precondition. But, you know, we have tendencies to all kinds of things, and it's a question of what work we do on ourselves. And I don't want to call that anger. I think that all the philosophers who write about this, like Rousseau was a good example, agree that anger involves causal thinking. You have to believe that somebody did something to you. And therefore, according to Rousseau, Emile has to be a certain age before he can have anger. Fear is much more primitive. And I think fear, the human fear, is probably not very different from rats and mice fear. And that's important. And it's what my next book is actually going to be about. But anger comes later, and we learn it in society. And that means there's so much room for social error to creep in. Well, so we should get rid of the social errors about which wrongs are significant, which ones aren't, and so on. But then we should just think about the futility of payback. And the Greeks and Romans, this wonderful book, which I strongly recommend, by the classicist at Columbia, William Harris, called Restraining Rage, he points out the complete history of anger and thought about anger in the Greco-Roman world. And this world was not unlike ours in all respects, because people got angry all over the place. But the big difference was that anger was not thought to be adult or manly. It was thought to be childish and womanish and to be avoided as you grew up. And so you find Cicero writing to his brother Quintus, who's out there being a governor of a province. And he says, well, Quintus, I hear some good reports of your governorship, but there's one thing that I don't really like. I hear you get angry a lot, and stop it. That's childish. It just diminishes you. So that was a standard attitude. Some people thought you should eliminate anger completely, like the Stoics, and some people thought you should just moderate it, the way Aristotle thought. But they all agreed that there's much too much of it, and that's a central social problem. I mean, look at the Iliad. The first word is anger, and then the whole problematic of that work unfolds from that place until we finally get reconciliation at the end.
Now, you just mentioned anger as opposed to fear. I came across a cohort study carried out by American doctors, and they looked at the response to 9/11. And they made a distinction. I don't know whether you can find yourself in it, but they made a distinction between people who reacted fearfully, and they seemed to have work themselves more often into a depression and all kinds of unhappy states, and those who reacted with anger, and that had a positive sort of proactive connotation.
Well, the people who said, "Oh, it's all the fault of the Muslims," I don't see that as particularly positive. So anger it depends entirely what you do with it. But look, I think very often when people are afraid, and when they feel helpless, they want to seize control. And anger gives you the illusion that you are seizing control. So it might well be connected with a temporary increase in a feeling of control and well-being. But in the long run, I mean, think about it, when your mother dies in the hospital, it's so common, certainly in the United States, to think, well, I can't grieve, I can't bear to sit there and mourn, I'm going to sue the doctor. And that gives you the illusion that you're in control. But actually, your mother is dead, and you have to grieve. And with 9/11, you have to mourn the people who die. And to get angry, it depends what the issue is. I think with respect to the political causes, anger is not very helpful. You need to figure out how that happened, how to prevent future things from happening, and do good intelligence work, and so on. But for the people who lost loved ones, and for the nation as a whole who lost lots of great people, including many, many Muslims who died there, we have to mourn collectively, and that's productive, because it brings people together. And I did notice a lot of that, and I thought that was very constructive in some very odd ways. I'm a baseball fan, and I was at a game, which was the first game after 9/11 in Chicago, that the dread New York Yankees had played, and there's great rivalry, and so usually you would boo when the Yankees come on the field. But this time, the Chicago firefighters who had gone to New York to help out in 9/11, they were applauded. But then when the Yankees took the field, everyone applauded. And so it was like the country came together and celebrated unity, reciprocity. And to me, that was the good response to 9/11.
Okay. So the book, if we take the book title again and the announcement of tonight, Anger and Forgiveness, what should we have instead? Reason and optimism.
Well, I think generosity and love. Now, King always said, the minute he used the word love, he immediately said, I don't mean romantic love. I don't even mean you have to like the people. I just mean a willed attitude of furthering their good, willing their good. And I think that's what we need so much more of in society. And I see it in lots of places in my country, in the people in South Carolina who had their family members shot at point blank range by a racist, and they expressed mutual love, but also love of him and a willingness even to possibly forgive him, because they were Christians and they saw it in terms of forgiveness. But even more, the gay and lesbian community, who I think have always been paradigms of showing that love is stronger than hate without asserting a kind of phony, aggressive masculinity. So after the nightclub in Orlando was shot up, instead of any demonstration of payback, they came out there and had a wonderful celebration of love and pleasure, and all of this is better. And that, I think, is what we should come together and celebrate the things that are good in human life. And then, of course, figure out sensibly how to make them more stable.
Before I give the voice to Town and Gown, there is one topic I wanted to discuss with you. Your entire book, also the lecture today, speaks of the individual. It's the individual that fears anger, and if he or she is successful, transforms it into something positive. Now, what we've been witnessing recently is something more like entire populations or entire classes being angry. There was the stereotype in the 1930s of the black angry woman. That was more a kind of stereotyping of a sort of physiopsychic condition of a class of the population. But then since the 1990s, we've got the white angry man. And now, of course, we've got the angry generation. Now, in your models, you always have the individual dealing with anger and transforming it. How should we deal with entire classes?
Well, that's a really great question. And I guess I would say, first of all, people feed off the emotions of other people. And there's this phenomenon called group polarization that's been much studied, where people who associate with like-minded people become more and more extreme in the point of view they associate with. Now, that is very much fostered by the internet, because now, instead of reading a newspaper where you find all sorts of different points of view, you can just single out the viewpoints of the people you already agree with. And I think that that is a particular problem created by the internet, and we have to figure out how to deal with that, how to make sure that people get true news instead of fake news, and so on. But I guess what I also see is just something that's the opposite of what you're pointing to, which is that people are really alone. When people use the internet, they actually are very, very isolated, and they're more cut off from criticism, from family, from monitoring friends. They sit in their room, and under cover of anonymity, they can say the most violent things. And so I think it encourages a kind of reckless individualism where, you know, these are often people who don't go to any church. They don't have a network of friends. They don't belong to any community that gives them a stable network. So I would almost say the problem is, in America anyway, too much rootless individualism. You know Robert Putnam's book, Bowling Alone. He long ago pointed out that Americans have lost the framework of community and networks of affiliation. And so all of a sudden, combining that with this powerful instrument, the internet, where they can just sound off and express violent threats, that's a very dangerous thing, I think.
Oh, no, it's very dangerous. Well, the question is, what response to formulate? Maybe you saw that 2 weeks ago, Stephen Hawking in the Guardian had an article that this was the most dangerous moment our planet had ever been through. And then he said, what we see is a population worldwide, and he pointed at Greece and at Brexit and at, you know, the Trump and so forth, saying what we have is a polarization with ever more people being left out of industrialization, computerization, and an ever smaller group of the elite. And then he said, well, this cry of anger is justified, and we as the elite have to make sure that we open up to the broad population. Now, when I look at your book, where the anger is never justified, anger is something that we have to overcome. But then the question would be, well, we cannot give to the 50% of the American population your book to get out of their state of anger and be constructive. What do we do, let's say, as the educated elite, in terms of the anger of the many that seems to be justified?
I don't think it has anything to do with elites. Gandhi's movement was a mass movement. Most of its members were unable to read or write. And King's movement was a mass movement. And most of the people were extremely deprived. So too with Mandela's movement. It's not, I mean, elites are often the most vindictive people in the world. The academy, because the stakes are so low, is often the place of the most vicious rivalry and anger. So I don't really agree with that particular way you formulated it. But I guess I think I'm not asking people to put aside their genuine protest. Protest is justified. We need to say these things are wrong, and people need to be held accountable for the wrong things they do so that society can move forward and have stable confidence that these values will be upheld. That doesn't mean payback. And South Africa, I think, showed that very clearly with the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. Truth, yes, but putting them all under the guillotine or something, that was just not going to move things forward. Now, I guess I also want to say, let's read history and let's not think that this is the worst of all times. The United States, the founders were actually fighting and killing one another in duels. They were beating each other with canes on the floor of the House of Representatives. There was a populist rebellion called Shays' Rebellion, where people took up arms against the government. There was another one called the Whiskey Rebellion. Again, people, poor rural farmers, taking up arms against the government. Then we had a civil war where, you know, large numbers of the nation were killed. So, you know, I would say this is nothing compared to those upheavals. Even the violence of the civil rights movement. I saw a wonderful production of Sophocles' Electra in Chicago, and I was fortunate and privileged afterwards to have coffee with the director, who's an African-American woman named Surette Scott. And she had been part of what was called the Black Freedom Theater, which went through the South during the 60s in the civil rights movement and performed dramas associated with the protest movement, but taking their life in their hands. Because, you know, people were being lynched, people were being killed. And she said all her actors were so upset after the election, and they felt, how can we go on, and isn't this a crisis like no other? And she just sat with them and told them about her life and about what it was to be a black woman, an actress in the South trying to move around and, you know, about to be lynched at any moment. Now, things are not like that now, and I think one shouldn't pretend that they are. We've made a lot of progress along a lot of fronts. People with disabilities are respected as never before. Gays and lesbians are respected as never before. Racism is a huge problem in my country, but it's not the problem, it's not the same problem that it was in the 60s. There's no lynching, and the law has evolved to be at the back of the protesters rather than hitting them in the face. You know, there's a lot of work that has to be done. Women have come a long way. You know, I came at just the time when women, the doors were opening, and I was the first woman to hold a particular kind of fellowship, which, by the way, I got an email just before this lecture. A young man, brilliant scholar from India, got the same fellowship. So he said, you know, I know you were the first woman, so I wanted to tell you that I got this fellowship. And he's probably the first Hindu, you know. So, I mean, there's a new inclusiveness, right? And I think it's great, and I think we should foster it and celebrate it, as well as correcting and working very, very sternly and aggressively against the problems that remain.
Wonderful. Now that my pessimistic question has turned into optimism, going through a transitional phase, I think we can open up the floor to the public.
Good evening. My name is Anne. I'm an Erasmus student from Germany. And my question is, maybe you answered it already, so just to be sure, how can I communicate with someone who does not to seem to me a person who can overcome and use his anger to a more constructive way? How can I talk with someone or argue with someone like that?
Yeah, well, it's certainly a challenge, and we've probably all faced that. You know, I mean, in my chapter on personal relations, I talk about this great psychotherapist, Harriet Lerner, who wrote a fine book called The Dance of Anger. And I would say, look at that book, because it does talk about both anger between adult children and their parents, and parents and the children, but also anger in spousal or romantic relationships. And what she says is that the trick is to get the both parties to realize that anger doesn't move things forward, that it typically cycles blame round and round. It creates its own routines and its own ritual. Oh, that's what you always do. No, but that's what you always do. And so she felt that what she needed to do was to get them to the point where they would confront what the underlying issue was, and that the anger usually was a way of not facing the underlying issue, such as, let's say, the wife wants to get a job and the husband is scared of that. So how do you do that? Well, she urged the person who was more ready to listen to do something surprising that's not part of the usual ritual, and just, you know, one day this woman whose husband was so scared of her being independent, she just goes to a yoga class, and the husband isn't where she usually is, and the husband's very upset, but he can't really say, well, you can't go to a yoga class. So, I mean, just doing something that breaks the routine was the advice that Harriet Lerner gives. But read the book, because it has great examples of that type.
Thank you very much.
Yes, I'm Gijs. I'm a political science student here at Radboud University. And you're also famous for your capabilities approach. And I would understand if people are angry that they don't get the capabilities that you are offering or that a government should offer. And I would understand if people are getting a bit desperate if they all the time do not get the capabilities that they should get to have a normal life. And so you would probably say, okay, you have to transit that angerness into something positive. But how can people transit that anger into something positive if a government still doesn't give them those capabilities?
Yeah, well, of course, it's an embarrassment to me that I have justified anger on the capabilities list. And the reason why that was I didn't have it. And then Catherine MacKinnon, the great feminist, said, you know, you better put anger on the list because that's very valuable for women. And I thought, well, you know, it's not the way I see it, but maybe I'm just an idiosyncratic person and my aversion to anger is just my own thing. And so I did put it on at her urging, and now I can't take it out again because the list can't be changed all the time. But I just point out that I would rather not have it there. But yeah, I think the thing is we have to have protest and we have to speak up. Now, I think that some societies positively discourage people from speaking up. I recently spent a length of time in Japan, and I was rather surprised to find out that women or people with disabilities, you know, who had many grievances, still, when something happened that was demeaning to them, they didn't say anything. They were afraid of making waves, even afraid of inflicting shame on the other party. And I think, you know, one of my young friends there said, well, you know, as children we're brought up to sit silently at the family table and silence is the great virtue in children. I think that's not a good situation. People need to speak up. And so first of all, I think that's the first thing I would say. Speak up, but not necessarily alone. If you form a movement with like-minded people, it's far more powerful, or you join a movement. Now, it took a long time to change South Africa. Some people got worn out by it. And we can see this if you read the Mandela correspondence, that Winnie really did get just totally depleted and worn out by it and turned into a very payback-oriented person who committed many, many horrible retributive acts. So don't let it get to your gut and poison you, but just hope that you can have a solidarity group of friends around you who can fight for the same things. And democratic politics is slow and it involves a lot of backsliding. But King said the arc of the universe is long and it bends toward justice. And I believe that's true. And I think you, even if you aren't sure whether that's the case, it's a good belief to internalize and act upon, because as Kant said, the hope for the future, the hope for better times to come, sustains you. And so he said, well, I can't really tell whether hope is justified, but I adopt it as a practical postulate to sustain my moral action. So I think that's important to do.
Okay, thank you.
Professor Nussbaum, thank you very much for your challenging and inspiring. Here I am at the back.
Oh, okay.
I'm standing here.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Thank you for your challenging and inspiring lecture, first of all. I'm an educational science student from University of Amsterdam, where we also study your work. My question was, you mentioned various historical figures, great historical figures, who were kind of naturally good at that transitioning with what you call, I think, status anger. But who do you think, with whom lies the key role to create ground to get to that third fork of anger?
Well, look, these were great figures, but they were not created instinctively. Mandela says he had to work on himself for years before he could get to that point. And Gandhi, similarly, I think he went through a long evolution, shaped his character very painstakingly. I disagree with his rather stoic repudiation of all emotions. So that road I wouldn't go down. And he repudiated grief and passionate love as well. And I would not do that. But, you know, these were people who weren't born that way. They worked on themselves. They exercised great discipline over themselves. And there are many, many unsung people. If you think about our civil rights movement in the U.S. and the anti-slavery movement before that, there are just so many heroic figures. There's Harriet Tubman, and there's just all kinds of ex-slaves who told their stories. So a movement consists, it's very lucky if it has a charismatic leader, as these three were, but it also is made up of many, many people who are not charismatic, who play their part. And I think that you know, in the U.S. now, there is no such charismatic leader, but fortunately, the legacy of King is very powerful still. Bernie Sanders did work with King, interestingly, and he led a nonviolent protest march on the campus of my own university, where he was an undergraduate, in 1962, in a way that exemplified the methodology of King trying to get Hyde Park housing to be integrated. And so, you know, today he is the living descendant of that nonviolent protest movement. There are plenty of others. There are plenty of people in the Black Lives Matter movement. So I think you can keep up the work without having that person there all the time. If you think about the major religions, they're all founded by some charismatic individual such as Jesus or Muhammad. But that person, long after that person goes, the spirit and the thought of that person sustains people's lives. And I think with political non-anger, it's the same thing. So we just need to figure out, you know, what role each of us can possibly play. Is it as teachers? Is it as parents? Is it as writers? And then play that role, because not everyone is going to be a charismatic leader.
Hi. I'm on the clouds. My name is Winston. I might sound a little out of breath because I just need to run back and forth downstairs, upstairs, just to get a hold on the microphone.
Oh,
uh-huh.
Okay.
You mentioned earlier regarding the culture that, you know, there's a lot of conditioning and anger. So I might also agree on what Sigmund Freud said, like culture could be at some point be an enemy to man. It's like preventing man from getting their goal of perfection. So when I think of culture, we also have words. And when I think of words, I think of definition of terms and words. So how can words contribute to shift the paradigm of cultural thinking? For instance, like when we use the word multicultural. So yeah. If we prevent this, if we like substitute this word for pluriformal, we're speaking of one nation or one civilization with a lot of myriads of different thoughts who could contribute to union. So how do you regard cultural perspectives in the way of using words? Because words are something that are really helpful to express our thoughts. So
yeah, I think that is very important. In the U.S., the search for more respectful words or new words is often pejoratively called political correctness. But I think it's really, really important because it helps people think in new ways. And actually, this is as old as the seventh book of Plato's Republic. At the end of the Republic, they talk about the rulers and they use the masculine accusative plural participle, archontas, because they're, you know, in Greek, that's unmarked. And so if you have a group of male and female people, you would use the masculine gender. However, Socrates doesn't like that. And he says, kai archousas ge, o glaukon. You better say the feminine participle too, o glaukon, because otherwise we won't remember that we're opening the leadership to all women who are capable of taking that position. And that is exactly political correctness, because it's violating the grammatical rules of the language for the sake of showing people something, reminding them something about the world. Now, long ago, we used to always say he as the unmarked pronoun in English in every scholarly article. And so that was thought to be, oh, that's just grammar. But now, in every philosophy journal, either you have he or she, or you might just use nothing but she, just to change people's way of thinking. Or sometimes people pluralize everything and write they. But whatever they do, they don't just use he. And it's very interesting that, you know, you read even Rawls's Theory of Justice. It was such a short time ago, and he still uses words like a man and he and so on. And now that just seems really wrong. I used to teach a class, the name of which was Ideas of Man and the World in Western Thought. Now, of course, man meant, you know, mensch. It didn't mean the male gender. But still, it did make people think, this is a history of males. And people did think that way. And people's expectations about who a doctor would be, who a lawyer would be, were shaped by that. So I think that's one very good example about how a shift in language that was demanded by feminists and that was initially ridiculed and pilloried as political correctness has taken hold. And I think it really does change thinking. There's a very good book that I cite in my anger book about how the language used to describe criminals is sometimes very slippery and it conduces to false views of criminals. So if you look up that part of the book, you'll see there's a lot of stuff that we say that's really, really escapes our notice but gives us wrong suggestions for how people are. So yeah, we have to be alert to that. And I think linguists have a big part to play in getting a just society. And I really do think that scholars who, you know, who observe these things and write articles about them, that helps us a lot because language shapes our visions of everyday life and the world. It's also a question of what examples you use. So if you give an example in philosophy, and the example is that of, let's say, a political official, it used to be just unproblematic that that official was described as a male. And then the example went on from there. But I think now people think, oh no, you shouldn't do that. You should mix it up and you should make sure that at least some women are introduced in positions of power. My daughter, who's now in her early 40s, she was already brought up on a book called Trudy Teacher, which deliberately had the occupations sprinkled randomly almost between male and female. So there was a female telephone line repair person and there was, you know, a male nurse and so on. And that was really helpful in getting expectations that you could do or be anything. So yeah, absolutely.
Thank you. Really appreciate it because words could press the button of yep. antagonistic behavior, but they also with all the key to unity. So thank yeah. you very much. Appreciate it.
My name is Micha Ben Michael. I'm from Israel. I studied here many years, and I'm in something like educational psychologist. Mm-hmm. I wonder about the conflict between Israel and the Palestinians. They hate each other, and they have the same right. What would you tell them how to solve the problem?
Oh, my God.
I
think that's one of those things that one shouldn't wade into without a lot of time and a lot of knowledge. I do actually have a lot of friends in Israel. I've taught in the law school at Tel Aviv for short visits and so on. And it's a very, very complicated country because Tel Aviv is one thing and Jerusalem's a different thing, as you, I'm sure, know. I think, quite frankly, that one of the biggest mistakes that Israel made in the founding was to turn religion over to the ultra-Orthodox. I'm a practicing Reform Jew. Our central passion is for social justice and inclusion, and we have resolutions recognizing the equal dignity of transgender Jewish youth, of gays and lesbians and so on. Reform Jews were not recognized and still are not recognized in Israel. I couldn't go there, you know, I couldn't have gotten married as a Reform Jew. I could get married as a Christian or a Muslim, but not as a Reform Jew. And the exclusion of Reform Jews from Israel influenced who goes there. Women don't want to go there because Jews are not religiously equal. And a lot of women, I mean, Reform Judaism, more than 50% of the rabbis are women. So am I going to go there and live there? I might have at one point, but not if I can't live the religious life I want to live. So I think they made a huge error in turning away the liberal, justice-oriented people. And then at the same time, there's this influx, as you know, of people from Russia who have no education in any kind of liberal values of any kind. And so it's shifted the demographics gradually and imperceptibly. So now the people in the Peace Now movement are in a tiny minority, increasingly tiny, and that's a real problem. So, I mean, that's the problem on the Israeli side, and it's very hard to solve without changing the power of the religious movements. And it's now kind of late in the day for that because they're very politically powerful. On the Palestinian side, we know that education of kids, teaches hatred, and that people are taught from a very early age to demonize Israelis. I went to a Palestinian school in Lebanon and saw Palestinian kids who, by the way, are ghettoized in Lebanon. They have no civil rights in Lebanon. They can't go to any public school. So you would think they would, after 50 years of this, they might protest against the government of Lebanon. But they're taught to focus obsessively and with hatred on the Israelis. And they have these self narratives that the kids of 5 years old were writing that says, my name is so-and-so and I come from blah blah street in Haifa, and when I grow up I'm going to kill Israelis and move back home. You know, so if you bring up people to think in that way, that their real home, of course 50 years later, is in Haifa and they've got to murder people to get there, that's a recipe for a terrible disaster. Now, on the Palestinian side, the person that I admire and love, and he was my student actually, is Sari Nusseibeh, whom I'm sure you know, the Palestinian leader, the former head of Al-Quds University in East Jerusalem, who wrote a very fine book. He's always been in favor of cooperation with Israelis. He's tried to, well, he has had a grassroots movement for peace with a former head of Israeli security, and he believes that we should criticize the Palestinians' lack of freedom of speech and lack of other important democratic values, and he's done this. And somehow or other, he criticizes the Israeli government too in very moderate and appropriate ways. He's avoided being assassinated, I think, only because he's from a very old family and people defer to him. But the fact is, there are increasingly few people like that. Even Mahmoud Abbas, who I think at some level in his past, at least, was really, I mean, that's he was a pal of Sari Nusseibeh, and he was a man of peace, but I don't know now whether that could be said. And so I think that situation is degenerating for the lack of peace-oriented leadership like Nusseibeh, who's now retired. He was going to invite me to speak at Al-Quds, and then it turned out, you know, it just wasn't really going to work to have a Jewish woman coming in there, and so on. So there are, it's now gone so far downhill that it's very hard to bring it back, I think, but we must just keep trying and work with as much hope as we possibly can for whatever shreds of hope for a two-state solution there would remain. That's all I can say.
Given the weightiness of the questions, I think we have time for one last one.
Hello, I'm Lemuel. I'm a philosophy student here. Nonetheless, my question is going to be a little bit primitive, probably, because I've always learned to distinguish between anger as an emotion and the response you give to that emotion. And as I understand you, that you really correlate very strongly the emotion of anger and the violent response it calls for in many situations.
Let me just stop you there to say that I don't. I mean, I think anger is neither necessary nor sufficient for violence. It always involves, I think, except in this borderline case I talked about, a wish for payback. But that payback may not be conceived of in terms of violence. It may just be, as I say, a wish that somebody has an unhappy marriage or something. And by the same token, and this is something I didn't include for reasons of time in this lecture, I do think violence is sometimes justified, but should not be undertaken in a spirit of anger. I think there are just wars. I think that when Winston Churchill urged people to endure blood, sweat, and tears for the sake of preserving Britain, it was not a call to anger. It was a call to self-defense, and that anger in self-defense is, I mean, that violence in self-defense is sometimes justified. I think Mandela understood that, and he decided, well, nonviolence had not worked. He kept with non-anger, but he turned to the strategic use of violent guerrilla tactics to get the thing underway. So I don't think violence is always bad. I think there are times when it is the only way, but I think it would be better for it to be undertaken in a spirit of non-anger. And as Seneca wrote his treatise on anger, addressed to his brother, who was a Roman military man. And this brother is imagined as saying, how can we have an army without anger? And Seneca says, actually, if you think about it, an angry army is a really lousy army. It's not going to follow orders. It's going to go to excess and so on. And I think we saw that, by the way, with the American army in Vietnam. It was an army that was brought up on hatred of the Vietnamese with all these bad words that were used about them. And they did go to excess. So Seneca had seen that, and he talks about Caligula, who was a very angry fellow, cutting off all the noses of the Ethiopians. So grotesque crimes against humanity are what you get when you have an angry army. But if you can have a non-angry army, then you will stop when you've achieved the objective of self-defense that you have. Even King said he thought that violence in self-defense was acceptable, but that for strategic reasons he wasn't going to do that in his movement because that would not succeed in the particular context that they were in.
If I may...
Go ahead.
Okay. I cut you up. So.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. If I may, the question was actually towards the anger part. Isn't it, in a way, healthier to see the transition you propose as a transition of anger instead of away from anger? Because it's still the same emotion that is felt that you maybe identify as discontent or something.
Well, I think you drop the payback part and then it's no longer the same emotion. Now, it is a piece of the same emotion, sure, but transition anger is a rare case. And even when people think that's what they have, there's often a lurking desire for payback. So we have to recognize what a radical shift that is to give up the payback part. And you then have to take up new sentiments, hope, love of others, the determination to work, and so on. But sure, you can keep the piece of anger that says that's a wrongful act and we think that it was a bad thing that occurred and we've got to change that.